carnivorous plants. In this video, we're going to discuss the species that make up this group, like the pitcher plant, the bladderworts, the sundews, the butterworts, and everyone's personal favorite, the Venus flytrap. Join us on our journey as we discover their secrets and just what makes them so carnivorous. In the Davis Arboretum at Auburn University, we have some of the species included in carnivorous plants, like bladderworts. Here, we see the wide diversity of pitcher plants in the arboretum. However, we don't have all of the species of this group. Not included in the arboretum are plants such as the butterworts. Also, the one that comes to everyone's mind when thinking of carnivorous plants, the Venus flytraps. And finally, pictured here in the red are the sundews.
As you can see, there are a wide variety of pitcher plants not only in Alabama, but also in North America, including Sarracenia leucophylla, Sarracenia purpurea, and Sarracenia rubra. To get more information, we interviewed a local expert on carnivorous plants, Dr. Debbie Folkerts.
Isn't it dormant?
Mm-hmm.
Spring, summer, and fall. Are there any characteristics unique to Alabama or our southern climate in general?
Yes, actually we are what we call a hot spot of diversity for carnivorous plants in the southeastern U.S.
Wow.
In the coastal plain, there are many areas that have exactly the environmental features under which plant carnivory has evolved. Sandy soil, and high rainfall. And you put those two together and what you have is soil that is leached of nutrients. High rainfall also means plentiful water, mm-hmm. Okay, which is important. Open, untreed habitat, so sunlight is plentiful. Fire is important in these habitats, and fire also helps to remove organic material from the soil and contributes to the low nutrients in the soil. It helps to remove tree and shrub vegetation to keep it open and sunny. And if you take these habitats, low nutrient soil, open and sunny, plenty of water, what that means is the only limitation to photosynthesis are the mineral nutrients that enhance the process. So that's where plants evolve. That's where the high selection pressure for carnivory is, and where carnivory has evolved, because that's the one limiting factor is the nutrients in the soil. And we have more of that habitat here in the southeast as a portion within the longleaf pine forest, more here than almost any place else in the world.
Who knew we were so special?
Who knew? Yeah. Well, we have, depending on your view of the taxonomy, 8 to 11 species of pitcher plants.
Do you
in
know
Alabama.
Them all?
Yeah, I do. Sarracenia is the genus. I can probably count them anyway. And so we've got the white top pitcher plant, which is Sarracenia leucophylla. We have the yellow pitcher plant, Sarracenia flava. That's the tall one.
One's already blooming in the arboretum.
In the arboretum, okay. We have the parrot pitcher plant, Sarracenia citicina. We have the purple pitcher plant, the one that has the like little jug shape and holds water, Sarracenia purpurea. Who am I forgetting? We have actually Sarracenia albumensis, which a lot of people now consider to be a separate species, but some consider it a subspecies of Sarracenia rubra, the small one. So if we count those as two separate, that's six. We also have the green pitcher plant, Sarracenia aureophylla, and Sarracenia alata, the winged pitcher plant.
A special characteristic of this group of plants is that they trap their prey. Each species of carnivorous plants has its own unique trapping mechanism. Normally we can't get this close, but luckily for us, this one's incredibly docile. Carnivorous plants use certain techniques to attract their prey. Some are visually attractive by being brightly colored, while others release a sweet smell to lure insects in. But how do they actually trap their prey? The pitcher plants use a passive trap that's called a pitfall trap, where the prey falls into a cylindrical leaf that contains a pool of digestive enzymes or bacteria at the base. The aquatic bladderworts implement their own exclusive bladder trap, a form of passive trapping. The bladders pump ions out and water follows thusly by osmosis. This generates a partial vacuum inside the bladder that traps small prey. The Venus flytrap uses an active trap called a snap trap. When something touches the hairs on a Venus flytrap, the cells on the outside layer of a Venus flytrap rapidly expand comparatively to the inside layers. This causes the mouth to close, They get larger every single time that they eat. The butterworts use flypaper traps. Leaves that use this form of trap have studded mucus-secreting glands. This produces a sticky surface that is effective for catching small flying insects. The leaf responds by growing rapidly and potentially rolling over the prey to further ensnare it. A combination of the flypaper trap and the snap trap is used by the sundews. The sticky surface holds the prey captive until the sundew finally snaps over.
Now that we see how these plants trap their prey, what is it that they eat?
Carnivorous plants are true carnivores. They capture and consume animals, mostly insects, to supplement the low soil fertility in their native habitats. Depending on leaf size and plant location, carnivorous plants feed on the flying, foraging, or crawling insects, such as gnats, flies, wasps, and even the occasional butterflies. Those near the water capture small aquatic prey, like mosquito larvae or tiny fish. Pitcher plants will eat about anything that falls into their trap, and proof of rats and birds have been found in some tropical species. The exoskeleton of the prey is left undigested, allowing scientists to determine what exactly these organisms have eaten. These plants do not require sustenance often and can actually be overfed. Fouling occurs in some plants when their traps are overfilled and the plant itself begins to rot. And of course, lacking a nervous system, these organisms do not taste their prey.
Carnivorous plants are an amazing group of organisms, but they can't do it alone. In order to discover their secrets, we must look at relationships other than predator and prey.
So there are specific insects that are adapted to living in carnivorous plants and avoid entrapment, and specific species of insects that act as their pollinators.
One of the most notable yet elusive organisms to exhibit symbiosis with a carnivorous plant is the pitcher plant moth of the genus Exyra. The pitcher plant provides the moth with shelter and protection for their young. Sadly, however, the larvae often harm the plant by eating away at the leaves, often harming vital tissues in the process. A more plant-friendly relationship can be found between pitcher plants and the diving ants, also known as Camponotus schmitzi. The ants help to break down larger prey in order to prevent fouling, as well as clean the peristomes of the plants, while gaining a nutritious meal and a safe shelter at the same time. Other organisms who have exhibited symbiotic tendencies with carnivorous plants include flies, mites, spiders, wasps, and some species of bacteria.
Now that we've seen how special this group of plants is their reproduction any different than other plants?
They're scattered throughout different families within the phylum of flowering plants. So they're all in the flowering plants, and they have flowers separate from the leaves, which are the trapping mechanism.
We have covered all the species of carnivorous plants in the Davis Arboretum, as well as a few featured guests such as the butterworts, Venus flytraps, and sundews. We have reviewed various forms of trapping, be it passive or active, as well as different forms of digestion, as in enzymatic or bacterial decomposition. We have discussed the type of prey these organisms feed upon, as well as the species that have developed a symbiotic relationship with these fascinating plants. To gain an edge on an environment lacking in nutrients, these organisms have beaten their counterparts to become carnivorous plants.
Thank you for joining us on our journey through the wonderful life of carnivorous plants. I hope you've learned as much and enjoyed this as much as we have.